Thank you. Now, Tony, let's see if I can get this to go into presenter view. That's a good start. We'll fill that with things, I promise you. Good morning, and thank you for having me. Tom, I'm honored to be here, and I can't tell you how grateful I am for you to give me this opportunity to speak to my peers. This just doesn't happen where you get a room assembled with the best and the brightest in the industry, and you get to pontificate to them. So I hope you'll indulge me for the next 26 minutes. I want to thank Tommy as well, Tommy and Sony Pictures. Tom and Tommy, they don't make money from this event. They genuinely stage this because of a deep and abiding love for sound. And we just don't have enough of that. Tommy mentioned, we were talking about this last night, that we all missed the bake-off. And one of the great values of the bake-off was not only that we got to geek out over the technical aspects of sound and all the cool work that people are doing, but we had this social event where we could all gather as a community. And I don't know if it's because I'm an Italian, I come from a big family, I believe in community and doing things in a family way, and this, I feel like, is my extended sound family. Finally, I want to thank Sony Pictures and Warner Brothers, who've been exceedingly gracious in preparing the two clips I'm going to show you this afternoon or this morning. I think it's worth mentioning that the studios didn't charge me to make these two DCPs that we're going to see. I'll let it be a surprise, but they do this as a courtesy to the community to show that they care about us. They care about the sound community, and I just like a round of applause for Warner Brothers and Paramount for ponying up. That's really important. So, good morning. Today, there is going to be no talk of plugins, panners, or Pro Tools. There will be no talk of crossfades, consoles, or crossover networks. Plenty of that to come. And for those of you now exiting the theater, there are no refunds. Today, I'd like to talk about us as artists. That's the theme of this keynote, to explore and examine and remind us of that touchy-feely side of our professional responsibility that is all too easily lost in these kinds of seminars. I don't mean to denigrate, but I feel like I need to be the antidote to technology, and that's what I want to talk about today. I like the term artist. It evokes a universal image of an individual who cares deeply about communicating to others some deeper truth. I'll tell you stories that I hope shed some light on and are instructive in how to do just that with sound today. You will also hear me use the term sound designer on occasion. Tom and Tommy both have used this term, and it's a fairly controversial term. I'd like us all to agree today that sound designer is us. A sound designer is simply somebody who uses sound creatively to tell a story. But first, I want to talk about the theme of this symposium, or the erstwhile theme of this symposium, immersive sound. On its face, it's an array of speakers in the theater that encompass and surround the audience, bringing greater sonic verisimilitude and a more lifelike experience of listening. A powerful tool, indeed, that aids the filmmaker in your suspension of disbelief. Invaluable as this tool is, I'm concerned that a reliance on just technology distracts us from our goal as artists, that of telling stories with sound. So, if immersion is indeed desirable, how do we use it? I think there's two primary ways we are immersed in sound. The first is physically. To be physically immersed means that we are surrounded by sound as in real life. using speaker systems like these and others you'll see today. The second is emotionally, using thoughtful and narrative sound to engage the audience, not just surround them. And this is what we do to tell our story. To show you how much more powerful I think emotional immersion can be, think of what happens when you fall in love. You meet at a beautifully romantic spot, and your partner looks fabulous. The clothes, the hair, the smells are all perfect. As your conversation flows and you get to know each other, the world, the environment, begins to disappear, doesn't it? The superficial trappings of the moment fade away and become unimportant, and emotionality takes over. Now, lest you think I'm making this up and this is some bullshit story just to make a point, I vetted my facts through the ultimate authority on emotion and immersion, and that's my wife. And she is here today. Honey. it was just like that when we met, wasn't it? Right? Everything disappeared, and all you saw was me? I love you, we'll be just fine. emotionality takes over. You are engaged by, and here I'll substitute, immersed in the moment, because the object of your desire was speaking to your soul and speaking to your more deeper needs. Just like in a movie. That's why we invest in a film, because of some connection to the emotional side of a story. We can be bombarded with sight and sound, the physicality of a movie, but I don't think that type of immersion is as powerful in engaging an audience emotionally. Sound can work on that emotional plane if you know to look for it. I didn't, at least at first. Early in my career, I had this groundhog-like day experience that changed my approach to my work. I felt awkward at preview screenings. Inevitably, after the scores were handed out, I'd find myself in a huddle at a bar with the director, the editor, and probably the producer or executive producer. And we'd be talking about how we felt the screening had gone. The director would go around the table and ask for the opinions of his creative team. The editor would lament that character X came off poorly because the audience didn't understand his or her backstory. The producer would be encouraged that the audience laughed at the absurdity of the protagonist's predicament. And when the conversation came to me, I would be dumbstruck and resigned to pointless inanities like, I think the gunshots were too loud and I think we should ADR that beach scene. Having spent far too many conversations like this with nothing to contribute, I had a simple realization that until I had a better understanding of the storytelling and a subsequent ability of how to leverage that understanding, I was less effective as a sound artist, and as a consequence, was left out of the conversation with my filmmakers. I really wanted to be in that conversation, the one they were having after the preview, but I didn't know how to contribute. I didn't even know the language. Having not gone to film school, where I assumed these kinds of things were taught, I set about teaching myself the fundamentals of story, structure, and character development. And I learned to use arcane movie terminology like the unreliable narrator or diegesis. This self-education process took the form of studying allied disciplines such as cinematography, improv comedy, and screenwriting, all of which informed and improved my skills as a sound designer or sound artist. I could see then, as I see now, the correlation between understanding the language of film and how that translates into effective sound execution and achieving true oral immersion. what became clear was that my success became less about the physicality of how I made sound and more about why I made sound. So while it borders on the banal, my talk today is a small discourse and gentle reminder on the idea that really great sound design begins with storytelling, just like film editing, just like directing, and just like producing. It sounds obvious, doesn't it? This may not be big news to many of you, and even if it isn't, I think it's worth reminding and reinforcing on a regular basis, just like your mother reminding you to brush your teeth. Today, I'm going to show you two clips from films I've worked on. These films were unique and somewhat bizarre anomalies in my career and in terms of your average sound gig, but I felt they were particularly instructive when it came to the themes I wanted to talk about today. I'm going to walk you through my thinking process, my belief and emphasis on the idea of sound as storytelling, and why I did what I did, and not how I did what I did. I find all too often our work gravitates towards technical discussions of how we do things. Lots of talk about plugins, sample rates, and mechanical attributes of sound in our craft. While clearly useful, I think learning how something is done creates the temptation to imitate. Imitation guarantees you will only ever be almost as good as the person you imitate. And it comes at the expense of developing a unique artistic voice, something I feel very deeply and passionately about. I'll tell you anything about my technique because I know those ideas are project-specific and transitory. How I designed sound on film A couldn't be applied to the sound on film B, and I don't encourage you to think this way either. When I start a new project, I prefer to explore the why of a film before I get to the how. The why begins with an understanding of the story from a dramatic standpoint. Before I create any sounds, I break down a script into story arcs, much like a director might do, to understand the film's language. I then build this breakdown into a sound script that references dramatic beats, not visual cues. I can't get to the how of building a soundtrack till I understand why I'm building the soundtrack. The latter can't exist without the former. When it does, we become this guy. Some of you may be familiar with this Larson cartoon. Do any of you see a sound person in this cartoon? Raise your hand if you do. All right. Has any of you ever had this conversation? Okay, no bites. Well, if you haven't, allow me to have it for you. To make the scene scary, I'm going to record a monkey scream with a parabolic mic and then import it into Pro Tools at 96 kilohertz and use the quantization function in my pitch shift plugin to dither it down to 8-bit, and then we'll use the Atmos panner to spatialize the divergence at the final mix. I think the director only heard to make this scene scary. I fear the modern sound artist is all too often seen this way. It's what keeps us out of the conversation, the one the filmmakers are having while we argue about sample rates and floating point architecture. It keeps us from being seen as authors and more like technicians. It's why we are all too often referred to by the many honorary societies as the technical awards. It's why we're all too often referred to as the sound guy. I hate this. Get me the sound guy. How often have you heard that on a dubbing stage or on a set? Why can't it be I need to speak with the sound designer, the audiographer, the director of sound, or sound artiste? Or even sonophile, my Latin favorite. My old business partner, Stephen Hunter Flick, used to muse that he wanted someone to give him the credit, sound swami, but I didn't feel that was particularly dignified. I'd love to be called any one of those particular names than sound guy, or any one of a host of other more dignified epithets akin to, say, cinematographer. No one says, get me the image guy. Sound has come a long way in my 40 years in the business, but our image hasn't. Let's transcend sound guy and technician by participating as the artists and collaborators we truly are. I feel when we learn to speak the why of sound, we're speaking the language of storytelling. In that process, we become authors of sound and we deliver a more valuable immersion in our films. Look, technique is critical, admittedly. In fact, I don't think you can get to the why without a full mastery of technique. And I think today you're all going to hear some great ideas and demonstrations about technique. I'm quite sure those panels are going to be fantastic. But if we live in technique, we live on the boundaries of creativity, we live in how and on the periphery of an emotional immersion. Ben Rosenblatt called me on a Friday and asked if I would consider working on a sequence in the new J.J. Abrams-directed Star Trek. Furthermore, if I were interested, could I have it done in 2 days? I must first make a disclaimer. I did not supervise this film. Mark Steckinger of my beloved Formosa group was the supervisor and did a masterful job with the film. I only worked on what is you'll see is a very short 2-minute sequence. And I was asked to basically bring a fresh perspective to this beat while Mark was busy doing all the hard work at the final mix. When I first listened to the mix of this scene, and it's of the Spock mind meld with Kirk in the middle of the movie, I was perplexed because it sounded really, really good. But JJ wanted something different. So I set about designing new sounds. I wasted a day creating things you've never heard before, only to feel that what I had achieved was different, but not better. That night, I had an epiphany. The sounds themselves were not, oh yeah, you get that. that's just great. I'm communicating. This is really lovely. The sounds themselves were not the problem. It was the design of the sequence. It was not telling the story JJ wanted to tell, and I'm not sure JJ even knew that. Having worked on 3 previous Star Trek films, I had some familiarity with the Star Trek narrative. I knew that a Vulcan mind meld was a tenuous method of communication, not unlike calling the moon from Cape Kennedy. The original mix of this sequence didn't work on that level. It was bombastic and played like a trailer for the movie in the middle of the movie. It conveyed no mystery and it underlined every story point. So I rung up my good friend Mark Binder, who is here today. A little round of applause for Marky B. This is his work on the screen as well. And we set about building the sequence from the ground up to tell a different story. One of a dreamlike half reality that teased and never pandered to the audience. We removed the score and built a more hypnotic soundscape from 12-tone scale orchestral samples and orchestral percussion. Sound effects were changed to be much more ambient, and dialogue was chopped up and processed to be considerably more unintelligible and far less expository. Easily, half of what JJ had written for this sequence was removed, or approved for that matter. We pretty much turned it on its head till it no longer resembled anything JJ would recognize. And so here is the final mix in what Mark and I achieved of Star Trek 2009. Let's watch that clip. Everything you hear there is the work that Mark Binder and I created. You heard some strings come in, orchestral strings. That's the first time score actually introduced itself. This sequence is nothing like what the director had originally approved or given detailed notes on to his team or Mark and I. The original score was gone. Most of Spock's overly expository voiceover was gone, and most of the sound effects were different. In a traditional paradigm, who should have been responsible for such a wide-ranging change? Who should make the critical decisions about how a soundtrack works globally, from a content and a creative standpoint? And what if that isn't the director? As our work has become increasingly compartmentalized, it seems we are content to worry only about our specialized domain: dialogue, music, sound effects. Sadly, the sound designer, the one person who I think should have dominion over the entire soundtrack, is only recognized as a sound effects creator, or is often seen as a sound effects creator. I contend that the true sound designer or sound artist is that person who has the whole soundtrack in mind, the person who has the ideas and convictions to address the entirety of the track and takes authorship of the creative decisions that serve the narrative. JJ liked the work we had done and understood that we were simply telling his story with sound. His approval validated my belief in letting the narrative guide my sound choices. While this validation was quite rewarding, the greatest gift from this experience was the credit that Mark and I received. Mind Meld Soundscape by. That is definitely the coolest credit ever. For now, still things to come. Quite proud of that. My most satisfying successes have come as a consequence of being direct and honest with my filmmakers. I screw up my courage and I take responsibility and creative risks by sharing what I think the story needs and how that translates into a sound approach. I fear that our sound culture hasn't built a tradition of participating in these kinds of discussions. And as such, we haven't learned that language or to be very direct with our filmmakers. Author Malcolm Gladwell talks a little bit about this notion of not speaking one's mind in his book, The Outliers, where he discusses this notion of mitigated speech. Mitigated speech is when we speak in a deferential way in order to be polite or show deference to authority, often at the expense of telling the truth and problem solving. When we engage in mitigated speech, we don't communicate clearly or directly about what we want or what we think works, and it stops us from being honest with our filmmakers. This is a Hollywood pandemic and should come as no surprise to anybody in this room. How often do we find ourselves searching for complimentary things to say to our filmmakers so as not to risk our political capital or alienate what we might think is an inflated ego? As Pauline Kael once said, Hollywood is the only place where you can die of encouragement. We don't grow from being yes men or women, and art doesn't get created without risk. It's at the core of its creation, or as Francis Coppola famously said, cinema without risk is like having no sex and expecting a baby. You have to take risk. Part of my message today, my gentle motherly reminder, is be courageous and speak your mind. We owe our filmmakers and ourselves honesty and risk-taking. I got the call on a Friday night, and I was in Sydney the following Monday. No one quite knew why the film didn't sound right, but they knew it didn't, and they needed help. Could I turn around a final mix that went off the rails? Could I put the director's vision back on the screen? And could I do it in 4 weeks? Thus began my 6-month odyssey of redesigning Mad Max Fury Road. The story of why Mad Max Fury Road didn't achieve its sonic potential is not made clearer by explaining the technicalities of what went wrong, though a great deal had. It just didn't fulfill George Miller's vision of the film. George had intelligently described to his sound team how to achieve success by using his top of the pyramid analogy. Whiteboarded here by our Aussie dialogue supervisor, Wayne Pashley, and if anybody wants a description of what it means, I'll give that to you later. It describes a methodology of determining what, at any given moment in the film, is the narrative concept and focusing on what one sound best tells that story. That's the top of the pyramid. All great re-recording mixers know this like their social security number. It's how to create focus and clarity in a mix. But unless the sound design has followed this from a content standpoint, success is mitigated and greatness is difficult to achieve. Yet, everything was there. In fact, an overabundance of choice was available. So much so that finding a point of view for any given scene made the final mix an agonizing exercise of sound design by the process of elimination. Sound familiar to anyone in the room? This is not fertile ground for excellence. The first pass at the final mix of the film was often characterized by a time-enforced abandonment of a given sequence while uttering, "That's the best we can do." Something had to change. The story of why Fury Road didn't achieve its sonic potential is made clearer by understanding that no one wanted to utter the unutterable to George Miller. Abandon the failed effort and start over. That's blasphemy, right? Tell one of the world's greatest filmmakers the soundtrack he had been directing for over a year didn't sound great and needed to be redesigned. Part of the dilemma of mitigated speech is just this kind of abdication of responsibility. Who would tell George Miller? But we owe this honesty to our filmmakers. I could see George's mounting frustration and inability to get his sonic vision on the screen. I knew the film could sound better, and Mad Max, any Mad Max film, just begs for jaw-dropping sight and sound. But it wasn't there. It was up to me, incumbent upon me, as an artist, to tell George Miller his V8 needed an overhaul and not just a tune-up. No mitigated speech here. I felt the film needed a complete rethink, that we just didn't have time for money, that we just didn't have time or money for, and I was ready to stand up for the consequences, telling the studio the film wouldn't be finished on schedule, needing 12 more weeks of mixing and sound editorial, and a sum with a lot of zeros after it. I had many sleepless nights in that first week in Australia where I imagined how my firing would look and feel. And that is an actual picture taken by Mia Stewart during my trials and tribulations during that first mix. But I'm happy to announce that my pitch was received warmly and with encouragement from George, who understood my sincerity, my vision, and what it meant to his film. We agreed that we would finish a first pass of the mix in Sydney with what we had, anticipating a return to Los Angeles, where we would start anew. And with the help of co-supervising sound editor Scott Hecker, and I'm happy to say, Chris Odd, did I just see you here? Chris, also sound designer for the film. Anybody else on Fury Road that I didn't see enter? Okay, I got you, Chris. Who did? And I think, Chris, you did Reel One? Spool One? You're going to see some amazing work by Chris Odd as the sound designer on this sequence. With the help of these gentlemen, we would redesign the sound of the film. This meant giving every sound meaning and intention and using sound to tell the story, beat by beat, top of the pyramid, making the vehicles, especially the war rig, the massive truck that Furiosa drives, recurring characters in the drama. They each needed personality as unique as the actors. They needed to do more than simply accelerate or slow down or travel from right to left, and should be threatening at one moment, a haven for safety at another. How does sound convey that? Sound needed to convey this very ephemeral aspect of Mac's deteriorating mental state and convey at times total isolation, as when Mac stumbles on the war rig during a massive chase and all the sound gets sucked out of the track, only to be jarringly reintroduced as his consciousness returns. We found allegory for action to inspire creative uses of sound. The chase across the desert became Moby Dick, with Immortan Joe as Ahab and the war rig as the great white whale. The truck moaned with the sounds of humpbacks each time it was harpooned, and the war rig hissed and fumed with bursts of the whale blowholes. These were the kind of narrative decisions we made reconstructing the soundtrack to Fury Road to give it greater life and impact. The value was not in how we used sounds, but having a why for them. This is what gave the track intentionality and, I think, a meaningful sonic immersion. So I give you now a small glimpse of our collective work on Mad Max Fury Road. I'm so proud of that film. I think it's an amazing film, and I hope many of you can stay tonight for the Atmos version of it. We're going to run at 7:30. None of that would have been possible without the expert mixing skills of Chris Jenkins and Greg Rudloff, who just did an amazing job on this film. And I might add that Junkie XL, Tom Holkenborg, wrote the score for the film. And while in Australia, give it up for Tom. He's just amazing in more ways than you can possibly know. Junkie took to me, or vice versa, I don't know, or I took to him immediately upon arriving in Sydney. We struck up an immediate friendship. And he and I, for the 5 weeks I was there, went to coffee every morning. Every morning at 7 o'clock, we'd meet for coffee. And we would talk about how or why the movie didn't sound the way it was supposed to sound. And we would lament the lack of cooperation between our respective disciplines. And in a movie like this, that cooperation is essential. So fueled by double lattes throughout the day, he and I developed this methodology that I've coined a phrase for. I call it collaborative sound design. Something we began to explore on Mad Max, but we brought to full fruition on Black Mass, which just came out. And I'll give you just a little peek at that. Tom and I have a very similar approach to how we begin our artistic process. It begins with gathering. It begins with just record the world. In Tom's case, it would be, but although we do it in similar ways, we start with acoustic sounds. We'll gather a large library of sounds, and then we'll start to bend them to create the palette that we'll work from. We refine it to become a palette. We kind of built that idea on Fury Road, but on Black Mass, Tom, because he's Dutch, he brought it. He 2 weeks into the film, he handed me a hard drive with 37 gig of all the samples he had created that he was going to build the score out of. And he said, here, use it. Build it into your sound design. And in this process, we developed this very, very seamless and organic, you know, that kind of thing we all strive for as sound designers, where it's music, is it sound effects, you know, all that nonsense. But it really worked. I mean, we had great success with this, and I encourage all of you to take similar risks that way. And if you happen to work with Tom, you'll be amazed. We sound artists have convinced ourselves of the importance of sound and its value to film. George Lucas famously said, sound is 50% of the movie-going experience. But does anyone really believe that? Do filmmakers give this idea lip service to make us feel good? I'm happy to report that Fury Road has given us concrete proof, scientific proof. Upon returning from Sydney with the original mix, we previewed the film in Burbank and got decent numbers. Subsequent to that preview, George approved my pitch, this idea of redesigning the sound to the movie. About 12 weeks later, we previewed Mad Max again. But what's important to know is that what we previewed was the exact same movie picture content-wise, VFX-wise, score music-wise. In other words, the only thing that changed was our redesigned sound and reimagined sound. It scored 8 points higher. Let me say that again, because this deserves applause. It scored 8 points higher with nothing more than an improved soundtrack. George would later tell us as we completed the final mix, Mad Max is a film where we see with our ears. I had no idea the enormous extent to which sound could help me tell the story. I have never experienced such a potent effect by the well-orchestrated use of sound. That's goosebump stuff, right? Well, for us. This from a director and a gentleman who has been making films for over 40 years. Sound design is storytelling. Regardless of your discipline in post, ADR editor, Foley artist, re-recording mixer, sound design is an emotional space you should live in as an artist where you know why you want to go somewhere sonically rather than how you're going to get there. It's about intentionality, and it requires courage, storytelling skills, and honesty. Fading out dialogue fills is piecemeal work. Making sure the gunshot is in sync with the muzzle flash is piecemeal work. It's not my intention to minimize the importance of good craft. It's how we learn what we do and gives us those crucial 10,000 hours so necessary to being experts in our discipline. But in the rushed environment that is modern post-production, where time management is an art, and we can only attend to so many aspects of our work, let's shift the balance. Let's put our finger on the scale and tip it towards sound as narrative and story immersion. I love the expression tabula rasa. It's Latin. It means the blank page. Everyone in the creativity business understands this concept, even if you haven't heard the term tabula rasa before. It's that awful place we start from before we get the idea. The space you and I want to live in as much as possible is on that page or on that console or on that workstation. It's that place where you make the leap from nothingness to originality. That's the place where you stretch your creative muscles and find new ways to tell stories with sound. Exercise that muscle. Ask why and not how. Seek emotional immersion. Speak the language of cinema. Be authors of content. Be honest and direct. Take risks and tell stories. Thank you very much.